So the topic announced, of course, it's related to the previous presentations. What do we have to achieve in patients with brain metastasis? It's known already. On the one hand, it's preventing intracranial progression and symptoms. On the other hand, preservation of quality of life and lifespan. How important is this problem? I would like to give statistics. Because during 14 years, we treated 18,000 patients, and this is quarter of our patients. So a special problem is large metastasis. There are different approaches to treatment, and today, when radiosurgery is playing more and more a role, and when we think about alternatives, small lesions or large lesions, so of course, when we see a picture which is shown on this slide, the issue of removal is not at place. Of course, we have to remove the tumor if there are certain signs. In any case, no matter how we would try to remove the lesions, so excision can result in high rate of local relapses.
These are the known effects. Well, there are different examples. The removal of the tumor doesn't mean that relapses won't happen. The standardized methods of treatment, it's necessary to radiate the place of removal. It's the example of a local relapse after WBRT together with toxicity. Unfortunately, in this case, we are not saved from local relapses. The arsenal that we have and that we use, mostly it's the radiation of the place of localization of the lesion. Depending on the volume, we use hyperfractionation. Usually, we step aside 2 millimeters from the lesion. We have a great number of data in the literature, but I'd like to draw attention to the fact that how it's important for a patient. The slide shows it's our work. The radiation in hyperfractionation mode can reduce the number of relapses, and we increase the local control double fold if after surgery radiation is applied. But there is leptomeningeal progression phenomenon. It may be different. Much attention is paid to this phenomenon. American authors, they say about linear nodular leptomeningeal progression. The very fact of removal of the tumor leads to this kind of threatening complication. According to different authors, if we use radiation after surgery, comparing to just only radiation without surgery, in threefold, we see the increase in the leptomeningeal progression, and the time frame is shortened by 3 and more months. And there are certain risks of leptomeningeal progresses. It relates, it's connected with the volume of the lesion of the primary tumor, for example, brain, breast tumor, localization in the posterior brain fossa. we should treat this phenomenon seriously. Clinical importance. So the works showed that if we are talking immunomodular tumor, patients died of neurological progression in 72-75% of cases. The majority of them, they require additional treatment. It's interesting that if we compare nodular or linear leptomeningeal progression, it's obvious that mortality in leptomeningeal progression starts earlier and the number of cases is greater. It's difficult to fight against this kind of complication. A new concept emerged: how to prevent the spread of the tumor during the operation. In 2014, the concept arose. It's Ashert, the author of this concept. To treat large metastasis, it's necessary to do preoperative radiation. Much work has been devoted to this, and we published our study. They showed that it does work. It's an important option of our current arsenal of treatment of large metastasis. This work was published. It's seen that different patients with different primary tumors, breast tumor, melanoma, NSCLC, different localizations, singular, multiple lesions were treated. And the results that we have, I'd like to draw attention to the fact that long time frame of follow-up, the local control in 90% in 1 year after treatment with a minimal complications, without neurological complications, with a minimal rate of radionecrosis, and prolonging life expectancy up to 17 and more months. It's one of the clinical cases. Here we saw relapse after hyperfractionated treatment. According to PET, it was combination of post-radiation changes and tumor progression. The tumor was treated radiosurgically, and the volume more than 25 cubic centimeters, the 15 gray exposure. It's a combination of the radio-related necrosis and tumor progression. Here we saw the image after the operation, post-operatively. One more point, that pre-operatively we should take into account, it's better borderline, better outlining, taking into account the fact that this patient has 15 more lesions. What could we do if we see this kind of hollow area? To do outline is quite difficult. Small lesions, they were perfectly outlined and radiated, but this whole lesion, we didn't outline the whole lesion, but some parts of this lesion, where we saw the remnants of the tumor after operation. Outlined tumor, if tumor is outlined, it's more comfortable to radiate patient preoperatively rather than postoperatively with postoperative changes. One more negative point into the preoperatively, it's the absence of verification. It's a breast cancer. The patient progressed. The brain metastasis appeared. This patient was assessed. It was assessed as metastasis. Radiation, radiosurgery was done. Then removal of the lesion, but it turned out It was a typical glioblastoma. We were confused. We didn't know what to do in this situation, to continue the radiation of the bed of the tumor or to follow the patient up. More or less, many works that were published at the end of 2018, they showed that preoperative radiation has advantages. It allows to reduce the risk of lambda-meningeal progression, to outline the tumor better, and to increase life expectancy of these patients. The phenomenon that we have discussed and that happened, many authors, they pointed out that much attention is paid to the radiological aspects of radiation and combination radiation and with immunogenetic shifts. Radiation influences and stimulates immune response, immunogenic response, and it's been proved that preoperative treatment in hyperfractionation mode, it is more important and it stimulates the immune system comparing to single fraction radiation. Here there are advantages and disadvantages of preoperative treatment, improvement of the local control, a reduction in the risk of lambda-meningeal progression, reduction in toxicity, radiation necrosis, and the improvement of the systemic control. Disadvantages, they are obvious. We don't have the morphological verification in this case. It prolongs the time before operation, and it may entail problems with wound healing. There are questions, indications for preoperative radiation. How does it influence the stimulation of the immunity and the technicality of the radiation, the maximum doses, the time of exposure? To solve these issues, studies are needed. Quite recently, it's an American author, so they said that it's very important, but even this analysis of the combined treatment, relapse, symptomatic necrosis, lambda-meningeal progression, of course, all these things, they are in favor of preoperative treatment. There are side effects. But on the other hand, the statistics showed that preoperative treatment, if it's used, it's American source, they will allow to reduce the costs for treatment of these patients. And today, everybody counts money, is very important. It was suggested, a randomized trial was suggested, the American authors. It's very important to randomize the group of patients for pre- and post-radiation surgical treatment. First of all, localization, posterior fossa or the local complications, the progression, evaluation of these things. So we, on the basis of this, we can prefer this or that way of treatment. Huge thanks, Andrey. Is there anybody who want to ask question? Thank you, Andrey. As usual, brilliant presentation. I have two questions. First of all, where is the borderline where we should do radio surgery or preoperative treatment in case of the size of lesions? And the second, in what time frames we should fit in with our surgery? We are in the beginning of our way. The indications are not completely defined. Many situations, they are, we make these indications just approximately. If we talk about large lesion or with and small lesion with edema, we are talking about surgery. It's known that surgery itself, combined with radiotherapy, is better than pure radiotherapy. Of course, if we are talking about safe resection, but if we see that this resection may bring harm to a patient, we prefer radiotherapy without surgery. As to time frame, the time of this treatment, we usually, we are concerned about edema if we use large doses and large lesions. Due to the fact, we have, it's the issues of quotas, we have to finish one treatment and then to initiate another treatment. But sometimes this time frame may be from 3 to 5 days. And during these days, we didn't see any problems for our patients. Of course, their standards are 24, 48 hours. But when we prolong the gap up to 5 days, we didn't see any problems at all. There may be some reasons. But in our patients, we didn't see any problems. But it should be in one neurosurgical department, not otherwise. It should be safe for a patient. Timur wanted to ask a question. Not into the mic, unfortunately.
As what concerns progression of the disease, is it defect of diagnostics or is it progression of the disease? Is there any dependence with the histotype, whether it's lung cancer or breast cancer? As to diagnostics, it's evident that there is no answer to this question. There are different levels of diagnostics, and we know. Yeah, I'm referring to our radiologists. It's not always clearly seen. Sometimes clinical data is more evident, although this is the matter of time. But as far as the figures given here, when they're verified, mainly this is the development of progression after treatment, rather than before. So we describe what we see. And yes, there is a regularity that at breast cancer, it seems that it's more frequent. I cannot tell what sort of phenotype it is, but with even non-small cell lung cancer and melanoma, it's less frequent. From the viewpoint of surgical tactics, or as neurosurgeons say, is there a difference to radiate preoperative lesion or when no radiotherapy was conducted? Within this time frame, 24 hours, there is no difference. Further on, this is also an arguable issue, an arguable question. More questions? Sergey Vasilievich. No, So depending on what sort of cancer, breast A or B type, 3-negative, whether there are all receptors to estrogen, progesterone. So you don't count it. It's just breast cancer, and that's it, and nothing else that you take into account. Or there are intraductal components at breast cancer. Sometimes it can have worse progression. Or is it just breast cancer that you take into consideration? From the viewpoint of technique of treatment, yes. From the viewpoint of indications to treatment, still, as a rule, we don't treat patients with primary breast cancer. We treat patients with metastatic lesions, those when, for example, it's a sensitive cancer and all other opportunities have been exhausted. Here we don't So from the viewpoint of our technique, so there is no difference. There has been no difference so far, depending on phenotype. But indications to treatment is another thing. A patient is sent by oncologists, yes, and you irradiate, it's radiosurgery. You give up to 14 lesions. Did I understand you well enough? No more. More can be much more sometimes. What is the dose given to each lesion? Again, we, depending on the number of lesions, their size and dose, we try that this dose, if the lesions are not so large, we try to give not less than 18 gray, if the situation allows. Well, 14 is the number which came from somewhere. No, we can give more. We radiated up to 40 lesions, the Japanese up to 80 lesions, but we had a case when there was 100, there were 100 lesions, there were several fractions given. We had this patient with whole brain radiation that she went through, and she had systemic therapy, and she had breast cancer. So we radiated 100 lesions, and according to Karnofsky scale, she has more than 90 points now.